Tawbah in this world, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe Tawbah is accepted. Like in my mind, and Imam Ahmed, when he said that your repentance will not be accepted, i.e. you're out of the fold Islam and you can't come back in the dunya. If you repent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive you. So now we're in terms of hukm dunyawi, they say no, the istitaba, they will not ask for that person to come back into fold Islam. But as you said rightly, the only unforgivable sin is kufr. And this is not, although we can argue that this is kufr as well, but even somebody who's a murtad going out of the fold Islam can come back in the dunya as well. Except for that, according to some imams. Why? Because we said application of rule in this world. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he may well make tawbah and he may well be accepted from what he's
done. Application of rule,
you
mean
you
want to know witnesses
will
accept his declaration of faith?
No. Yani what happens with a murtad? Somebody leaves a fold of Islam. He's brought in front of a court of law. His shubha, the reason why he went into a state of kufr, that will be discussed and clarified. To see, and the Qadi is now going to discuss with him, why did you reject Islam? What was the basis of it for this reason? Why are you rejecting it? This is the reason. So he'll clarify it now. So to try and show, this is the preferred way. And then he's given, in the Hanif Madhab, say 3 days. He's given 3 days now to reflect over it. It's his choice now. You remain in kufr. You've rejected Islam. You've reneged from Islam. If you don't come back, even as a hypocrite, you're going to be put to death. That process of now presenting it and allowing him to come back in, that's what Imam Malik can say will not take place. He's not given a second chance to come back into Islam.
So then he's going to put to death.
Yeah, he's going to put to death. Even if he repents. And he said, with Allah's power, your repentance may well be accepted.
Why should we agree of, you know, the accusation that you said, something to denigrate the Prophet, but you didn't know
there's an ikhtilaf amongst it. And again, this is speaking from the madhab of Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. Like, if somebody makes a statement of kufr based on ignorance, There's a difference of opinion over that one. Generally, it's held that if it's genuine out of ignorance and then he realises that it's not, then he's not considered a murtad. He's not considered a renegade. But the fuqaha jurists do say, if you have an issue on which there's a difference of opinion, is it kufr or not? They say the qadi will not, the judge will not apply the ruling that he's an apostate, but he's advised to take your shahada again. To be safer, and if you're married, renew the marriage contract just for safety. But in terms of application, the judgment, what's an example of something about which there's a different opinion of kufr? Is he an apostate? Somebody says you're a kafir. What did the hadith in Sahih Muslim says? Whoever accuses a Muslim of being a kafir, one of them is. So what's the case here now? To prove that he's not a kafir, is you're a kafir? Are you a murtad now? Have you left the fold of Islam that you need to take shahada? We have an ikhtilaf on that one. Some say the Prophet literally meant you become a kafir now, which means you would have to take a shahada and come back. Somebody accuses another Muslim of kufr, so you best now check whether he's a kafir or not, because if he's not, you're going to have to take shahada again. Yeah. Some say that's a literal statement. Others say it was a little taghleed to highlight the severity of what you're doing. The Prophet said it's as if you fall into kufr by doing that. But because you've got an ikhtilaf there, a difference of, is that a kafir or not? Has he left the fold of Islam? The safest thing is for, if somebody in the past, surely you'll never do that again. Somebody in the past has gone around accusing Muslims of being kafir. Say, take your shahada. Safer just to say, shahadu la ilaha illallah, shahadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. You're married, do your contract again. Get 2 witnesses, agree the hour again with her, and go through the process. Safer thing is just make sure you don't do so you don't need to pay your wife every time. Paying for the dowry every time.
Yeah, and the second question is like, for example, I was saying, like, if I makes a false claim about apostasy, that same way that you're saying now, you know, like, for example, he says to my father, so that's something.
Yeah, people have to be careful. Claims of apostasy and claims of kufr, people have to be very careful about
that. Like, it happens a lot in, like,
I know it happens all over the place. Not just Pakistanis, all Muslims do it. There's hardly a Muslim left on the face of the earth at the moment. Like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Sharh Nukhbat al-Fikr, he said, if we took into consideration, like every single group says the other group is a kafir. Like, so like the Salafis say the Sufi is kafir, the Sufis say the Salafis are kafir. Alhamdulillah, that's why I'm happy the brother said that our brother's the Salafis. That's good, man. Alhamdulillah, now we're getting away from the fact that they're kafir. But the Umayyad is saying that the Brahmin is a kafir. The Brahmin is saying that the Umayyad is kafir. There's not a Muslim left on the fold of the earth. There's not a Muslim left on the fold of the earth, except for me and my Imam. Me and my Imam, and sometimes I've got doubts about my Imam as well. And what's that? I think in the converts got issues about their faith as well. There's not a single Muslim left on. That's why Ibn Khaldun asked, I said, if you took the statements of all of these different groups, there's nobody left as a Muslim on the face of the earth. So just ignore them all. So now we're going through the hierarchy within prophets. We've got three tiers within prophets.